Penguin Random House Audio presents Sleepless, Unleashing the Subversive Power of the Night Self by Annabel Abbs-Streets. Read for you by Karin Cass.
Prologue. Why does one feel so different at night? Catherine Mansfield, At the Bay. This is a book about a journey I neither planned nor prepared for. A journey I never expected to take. A journey that would once have terrified me. This is a book about a journey into darkness and sleeplessness. Even these two simple words, darkness and sleeplessness, are freighted with all that we have come to fear and loathe. Inevitably, my journey was precipitated rather than chosen. And yet, despite my frequent fears, I found a world that was utterly new, one that soothed, intrigued, distracted, enticed, and exhilarated. To my surprise, the inhabitants of this strange and unfamiliar place became my companions. They ranged from the tiniest of nocturnal insects to the stars above, to women who welcomed a darkness thicker and purer than we have ever known. But of all my companions, none astonished me more than my night self. This book is about the self we find at night. In recent years, it has become evident that we humans are subject to manifold and constant circadian change. Chronobiologists have discovered that our bodies and brains behave differently according to the time of day, and that we all work to a set of biological patterns, often referred to as our circadian rhythms, or simply our body clock. This 24-hour clock is bound to light and dark, day and night, and etched so deeply in our biology that we cannot shake it off. In nocturnal darkness, the contents of our blood, breath, bones, saliva, and skeletal muscle change. We produce different hormones, which rise and fall according to the hour. Breast cancer cells divide more quickly. Our muscles weaken. We metabolize alcohol more slowly. Our bones are rebuilt. Our fat cells, kidneys, and intestines operate with a peculiar sluggishness. Dead cells are shed from our skin. Our temperature falls. Our appetite fades. Our blood pressure drops. Thanks to a litany of metabolic, cardiovascular, and endocrinal alterations, we are physiologically different at night. Our brains are altered too, most notably as they cycle through a series of sleep stages. But early investigations into the awake-at-night brain suggest that it too swims in an altered sea of biochemicals, making us feel different, rendering us, as the writer Virginia Woolf once put it, no longer quite ourselves. For women, who are twice as likely to experience insomnia as men, these endless shifts are compounded by barely understood infradian rhythms and hormone change, adding to the complexity of our nights. Awake, in the purring, softly melancholic darkness, we are no longer our day selves. We are subtly altered, our brains now wired for nocturne. Women are also powerfully and disproportionately affected by the absence of light. Dwindling illumination penetrates our brain, nudging it into a heightened state, amplifying our inner voice and compounding the alterations that strike after dark. All of which is to say, we are different. We are our night selves. I didn't know it at the time, but my night self was to become a powerful instrument of consolation and imagination, of healing and hope. This book is not a paean to insomnia. Rather, it is an attempt to remove some of the anxiety that now accompanies not sleeping, to understand why we don't always sleep, and to remind ourselves that women throughout the ages have suffered from periods of sleeplessness and survived, even thrived. It seems to me that insomnia is neither illness nor affliction, but our body and brains attempt to express and comprehend loss and absence. This could be the loss of someone we love, or the loss of darkness, silence, rest. For millennia, women have snatched time from the night to write, paint, learn, reflect, finding a solitude, creativity, and productivity rarely available during daylight. For millennia, women have endured sleepless nights caring for the young, the old, and the sick. Indeed, new research suggests that females may be in possession of uniquely robust circadian clocks that enable us to do this without as much detriment to our health as headlines suggest. And yet, our relationship with darkness is fraught with complication. While private darkness has long been female territory, public darkness has invariably been male space. And so this book is as much an exploration of our fractious relationship with the dark as it is a deeply personal account of what happens when we accept our night wakings, embrace our night self, and open our hearts to the disappearing dominion of darkness. 1. The Night Self. Truly, poor night, thou welcome art to me. Mary Roth, Sonnet 15. It's Sunday, the 6th of December, and I'm running down a narrow country lane. It's the first time I've run for months. I usually prefer the slower, more contemplative pace of walking, but on this particular day, which is to change the balance of my life forever, I am running. The air is thin and glittering, and so cold it pinches the insides of my lungs. I feel the virtuous exhilaration that all morning runners feel, and decide that my New Year's resolution will be to run more often. It doesn't occur to me that there might not be any New Year's resolutions, or that these feelings of virtuosity and exhilaration could be the last I experience for some time. As I approach our cottage, my phone rings, which surprises me because it's only 8:45 a.m. I expect to see my husband's name, Matthew, on the screen. To my surprise, it's my father's wife, who I shall call L. Hello, I puff, wondering if she's phoning to discuss our Christmas plans. I've invited her and my father for the traditional meal we always celebrate with them, supper on Christmas Eve. Since my parents divorced, Christmas has been a delicate navigation. For 22 years, my siblings and I have juggled growing families, jobs that don't stop for the holidays, elderly parents, acrimoniously divorced family members, multiple locations, diverse dietary requirements, and so on. Which is to say, all the usual complications of a family Christmas. This year, things have been compounded by the COVID-19 pandemic, meaning that only a certain number of family members can be together. And because of the growing death toll and the lack of a vaccine, although early batches will be made available within the next 2 weeks, a heightened feeling of anxiety pervades this year's festivities. My father is particularly alarmed and has gone to excessive lengths to avoid catching COVID. I'm half expecting him to cancel our supper plans. All this bubbles into my head as I shout into the wind, "Hello?" "Your dad," says Al. "The paramedics are here." I don't understand what she's saying. Why are the paramedics there?
"He's dead," she says.
She sounds so calm, so dry-eyed, I assume I've misheard her. Besides, her words make no sense. Firstly, he can't be dead because I spoke to him 2 days ago and he was fine. Secondly, if he's dead, what are the paramedics doing?
"A heart attack," she adds.
"I'll drive over," I say. "I'll be there as quickly as I can." I can hear voices in the background, as if Elle is conferring with someone. "Why aren't they resuscitating him?"
"They say you must drive very carefully."
Her voice is still oddly calm and measured.
"The police, I mean," she adds.
"The police? Why is Elle with the police?" I hang up, and then I start to scream. I am running and screaming and crying all the way home. 3 words play over and over in my head. "I'm not ready. I'm not ready. I'm not ready." This is where it starts. And later, much later, I think how strange it was that something so decisively ending was also something that was so clearly beginning. Matthew drives while I call my sister and then my brother. My sister drops the phone, and I hear her screaming and screaming. My brother is very calm. Later, I realize that I was too blunt with my sister and too vague with my brother. I know this because after an hour, My brother calls back and asks how the paramedics are getting on, and I have to tell him that our father has been dead for nearly 12 hours, that there was never any chance of resuscitation. Then my brother says the very thing that had struck me when Elle called. He can't be dead because I spoke to him last night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.